Am I audible now? Can able to screen see the screen also na? Nice. Yeah. Good evening, friends. Sorry for the disturbance. Due to some technical error, it happened. So today we'll be focusing on ECG basics, as well as we'll be focusing on how to approach an arrhythmia with regarding to ECG, and as well in a PHC or in a referral center, how are you going to manage that arrhythmia? All these things we'll be seeing today. Okay. Yeah. Good evening. So let's start. Is the screen clear? Okay. So yes, I want it to be a interactive session. So it's better that you both guys interact with me. So it will be an interesting session at the end of the day. Okay. So nice. So what is an ECG? What does an ECG record? Actually, in our heart, if you see, this is the cheapest, least expensive creation that has been done to record the electrical activity of the heart. So actually, in heart, what happens is there is electric current is produced by our pacemaker SA node, and it will be traveled through the atrium, then it will be going to the AV node, then it will be conducted to the bundle of His and Purkinje fibers, then at the end to the ventricles. So our aim is to record this electrical activity. Okay, once this electrical activity ends, the mechanical activity starts. Mechanical activity means the atrial and ventricular contractions. So yes, so now we are going to see how the electrical activity starts from the SA node, travels through the AV node, and how this creates electrical activity. Okay, so first we'll know some basics, and then we'll progress to ECG. Yeah, so can someone say what is depolarization and what is repolarization terms? What is depolarization? Activation. Okay. So first, we should be familiar with two important terms, which is depolarization and repolarization. Depolarization means a cell is. This is the normal resting map. The cell, usually it will be electronegative in nature, interior will be. So what happens is, as Nidhi Chauhan told, cell is getting activated by depolarization. How? By the entry of positive ions into the cell. So positive ions into the cell creates this electrical difference, which is measured by the ECG. This we call it as depolarization. So let's see how it happens from the beginning. Yes. So, yes, first you should know the ECG paper. When I was reading, though, I found it difficult to memorize this variations, this box. See, in an ECG, we will have one large box and small boxes. Can you say the length and width of the small and large boxes? See, what happens is this electrical activity will be measured by this paper, ECG paper, and this corresponds to time. Okay. Can someone say what is the speed of ECG paper? Speed of ECG paper. Yes, Shesha, good. It is 25 mm in 1 second. Okay. If you find it difficult to memorize how much second is one small box, one large box, just remember this. Speed of an ECG paper is 25 mm in 1 second. Which means, see, this small boxes contribute to 1 mm. Okay. So, 25 mm is traveled in 1 second means how much seconds will take for 1 mm to travel? It will be 1 by 25, which will be 0.04 seconds. Okay, so time is 0.04 second. One small square corresponds to, in x-axis I am saying, this axis corresponds to 0.04 seconds. And five small boxes join to form one large box. So, one large box takes how much second? It will be 0.2 seconds. 0.04 into 5, which is 0.2 seconds. This you should be familiar with respect to ECG paper. Next, y-axis corresponds to voltage. Voltage meaning, see, 1 mm corresponds to 0.1 millivolt. So, one large box will be 0.5 millivolt and two large boxes will combine to form 1 millivolt. Okay, this is the basic measurement with respect to an ECG paper. When you see an ECG paper, you should be knowing this basic measurement so that we can measure different duration of P waves, PR intervals, RR intervals, everything can be done only with this basics. So, if you forget this 0.04, 0.2, you can have a clue that 25 speed of ECG paper is 25 mm in 1 second. So 1 mm will be traveled in 1 by 25th of second, which will be 0.04. Five small boxes joined form one large box, which is 0.2 second. And in height, it is 0.1 millivolt. So 0.5 millivolt as a large box. Okay, everyone got it till this? This is the basic measurement of ECG paper. Can we proceed further? Okay, so next is yes. So next we are going to see the waves of an ECG. Okay, first we are going to see what is a P wave. So as we told, depolarization will start. Okay, we'll start this electric current from the SA node. The SA node is the current generator. It generates current at rate of 60 to 100 beats per minute. SA node. This travels through the, this part is the atrium, and it causes atrial activation. It causes depolarization of the atrium. So what you should remember with respect to this is, see here, actually, here is the SA node, which is situated in the right atrium, and here is the AV node. So, the current takes only less amount of time to reach the AV node. Okay. At the same time, the current takes longer time to depolarize the left atrium and come here. Okay. So, what happens is, the current is stayed prolonged for some period of time in the AV node. Okay, there is a normal AV nodal delay. Normal AV node is delayed because so that left atrium is completely depolarized and returned to the AV node. Okay, so this is there. So this depolarization produces the T waves. Okay, how will be the amplitude of the T wave and how will be the duration? See, when you just memorize duration of T wave is this much seconds, amplitude of T wave is this much second means you might forget it. So better learn it in a pictorial manner. See, I have drawn like, see the depolarization, as I told, it will proceed down first, then it will proceed to the left. Okay, so the lead 2 is like facing towards this depolarization. Whenever a depolarization vector moves towards a lead, that produces a positive wave. Okay, so according to lead 2 is situated here. We will learn about leads later, but for now, just believe me, two leads we are going to see here. One is lead 2 and one is V1. V1 is chest leads. V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, we'll keep like this. So, with respect to these two leads, I'm going to say how is the T wave is going to present. See, yeah, lead placements I will say in detail afterwards. For now, just remember these two leads, lead 2 and V1. So, what happens is this depolarization spreading from the SA node is to a, this produces a depolarization vector which is a positive vector because this depolarization vector moves towards lead 2. So, it is a positive vector and at the same time, what is the duration and amplitude? Just remember this, take one large box. Okay, half of the length and half of the breadth is the normal duration of a P wave in lead 2. Okay, half of one large box and half of one large box in both x and y axis. So now, can you say what is the normal duration of P wave and what is the normal amplitude of P wave? Okay, try it out. I have told half of the one large box. So, can you say what is the normal duration of a P wave? 0.1 second. Okay. See, 0.04 for one small box. This is covering 2.5 small boxes. So, 0.04, 0.04, 0.02. Which will be nice. 0.1 second. What about the amplitude of P wave? Yes, good. Maurya Tarni. It is 0.25 millivoltage. See, this is the normal P wave. So, as we see, first half of depolarization is due to what atrium is getting depolarization the first half? It is right atrium. And second half of P wave is due to left atrial depolarization. This produces a normal P wave. This you will be understanding when we discuss about abnormalities of P waves. So next is V1. What about V1? How will be this wave in V1? See, first it is coming towards V1. Okay, it is coming towards V1. Next, it is going away from V1. So, what happens is, in V1, there is, if a depolarization vector moves towards the lead, it is a positive wave. If a depolarization vector moves away from a lead, it will be a negative wave. So, here, first half is right atrium, next half is left atrium. Okay, everyone got till this? Yeah, equiphasic complex. This is the normal P waves in lead 2 and V1. For P waves abnormalities, if you want to see, just see lead 2 and V1. Okay, can you move forward? Okay. Now is it clear? Now is it clear, Elijah? Is it clear now? Okay. Okay, done. So now we are going to see the abnormalities of P wave. So what happens here is, so what happens here is, see, in right atrial enlargement, this is the right atrium getting enlarged, and this is the left atrium getting enlarged. So what will happen to the P waves in these conditions? See, right, if it is right atrial enlargement, means the depolarization will come with greater force and it will immediately activate the AV node. Okay, it will come with greater force because right atrium is enlarged, and it will activate the AV node. Small portion of left atrium, that won't matter. So what will happen to lead 2? First question is, what will happen to the voltage? What will happen to the duration? First is, see, with regards to duration, if the, since the electric current starts from the right atrium itself, so it can reach the AV node within the stipulated amount of time. But since it is hypertrophied, the strength of P wave will be more. So what happens is, here the amplitude is affected. See, so what happens is, see, normally 2.5 times of a large square should be there for normal P wave. But here it is too much. But the duration is normal. Okay, voltage increases, but the duration is normal. So, can you say what is the name given to this P wave? What is the name given to this P wave? Good, Arya Madan. It is Ranjit Dodi. Wait, I will say. This is P pulmonale. Good. At the same time, if you see, left atrium is getting enlarged. So what will happen? The current will reach the AV node, but still it needs lot, it takes lot of time to go around the left atrium and come to the AV node. So what will be affected, voltage or duration? Here, duration will be affected. So If you see the P wave, it will be like this. Like this. Right atrium is getting depolarized normally, but left atrium is getting prolonged. As we told, half of P waves, first half is for right atrium, next half is for left atrium. Since left atrium is enlarged here, so it takes longer amount of time to depolarize. So this is the P wave in left atrial enlargement. Now, Ranjit Jyoti, this is P mitral. Because left atrial enlargement will be seen in mitral stenosis. Okay, so they have given this name as P mitral. Okay, nice. So at the same time, now it's your turn to guess how will be lead V1 in P pulmonary, in this right atrial enlargement. How will be this lead V1? See, V1 will be here. So what will be there? Yes, tall P wave, good. It will be a tall P wave because the entire strength is coming towards V1. So it will be a tall P wave and then smaller part of left atrium, depolarization. So it will be a small negative deflection. Okay. So this represents right atrial enlargement in lead V1. Can you understand? Yes, positive component increases. See, this first part is the right atrium part. Next part is the left atrium part. Here the right atrial part increases. That's all. And here what happens? The left atrial duration increases. So it will be like this. Okay. So, in short, we can see like this. See here. Normal P waves. First half right atrium, left atrium. Here, only amplitude is increased leading to P pulmonale, and if duration is increased, it is P mitral, which is right atrial and left atrial enlargement respectively. At the same time, in a normal ECG, it will be an equiphasic complex in V1, and in P pulmonale, what happens? This right atrial component increases in amplitude, and in left atrial enlargement, this negative part of the complex increases in duration. This is with respect to P wave abnormalities. Can you understand? Can I move forward? Okay. Nice. Okay. Next is, see, we have finished P waves. Next, with respect to this part, we have finished atrial depolarization. Next, I told current will stay in the AV node. So at that time, no electric current will be transmitted here and there. At that time, it will be a no voltage will be there. After P wave, no voltage will be there. Okay, that corresponds to what interval? Can someone say? Here, this is the PR interval and this is the PR segment. Actually, in ECG, there is two components. One is segment and one is interval. Segment means that particular segment alone. If you say PR segment means only this part. Okay. At the same time, if you say interval means it should include a wave plus segment. So a P wave plus this segment will contribute to PR interval. This is very important with respect to bradyarrhythmias approach. So how to remember the normal duration of PR interval? Can someone say? Normal PR interval can be assessed, just you can remember like It is one large box. That's all. One P wave is completed in 2.5. Sorry. 2.5 small boxes. We completed a P wave. Remaining 2.5 small boxes, it takes for PR segment. So, if they ask PR interval means, it should be exactly one large box. Okay. Normal PR interval is one large box. That's all. One large box means how much it should be? 0.2 seconds. Okay. If it exceeds this, then we will be calling it as prolongation of PR interval. Okay. We have seen. Yes. Good. It is 0.2 seconds. So, if it is prolonged than 0.2 seconds, then we call it as prolongation of PR interval. This will be very important with respect to daily arrhythmias. Okay. Nice. So, PR interval also represents the duration for depolarization of the atrium and current to stay in the AV node. Till that. Good. Surya. Nice. Next is, see, QRS complexes. What does QRS complex signify? Next, the current starts to depolarize the ventricles. From the atrium, current starts to depolarize the ventricles. How it depolarizes? There is a specific pattern for it. See, this is AV node. This is bundle of His. This is Purkinje fibers. Okay. The fastest conducting fiber is Purkinje fibers. The velocity, they will say 4 meters per second. Okay. Nice. So, what happens here is, this depolarization vector comes to the bundle of His. It depolarizes first from left to right. It depolarizes the septum. Okay. This septal depolarization will produce our Q wave. Septum is getting depolarized first. That too from left to right direction. That produces a Q wave in QRS complex. Next, what happens? This Purkinje fibers depolarizes all the ventricles. So, that will produce a net positive vector moving like this. So, that produces the big positive R wave. Okay. Next, at the finally, last part we depolarize is the base of the heart. That produces S wave. So, here you should know the terminologies. Q wave means, see here, the first negative deflection in ECG is always called a Q wave. Okay. It can be like this. It can be like this. Okay. Whatever the QRS complex configuration, first negative deflection, we call it as Q wave. Then, the first positive deflection in QRS complex, we call it as R wave. Okay. It can be like this. It can be like this. Okay. Here we call this as R wave. That's all. In this QRS, only R complex is there. And in this QRS, what and all is there? First, it is Q. First, negative deflection. And there is R. We call it as QR complex. And now it's your time. You should guess this. What is this wave? How will you call this wave as? How will you call this wave as? The wave I've drawn now. Good. Kalpana Ravi, Ganesh Kumar, nice. It is RS. Good. Moriya Tarni. See, first it is first positive deflection we call it as R wave. Then, any negative deflection after a positive deflection, we call it as S wave. Okay, S wave definition is this only. Any negative deflection after a positive deflection, we call it as S wave. So, in ECG, you shouldn't be expecting all the leads to have this QRS complexes. Okay, most of the leads will have QR, QRS, RS, anything might be there. So, depending on this, you can, this nomenclature is based. Okay. Yes. So this is normal QRS formation. It is due to depolarization of the ventricles. Okay, and we saw the nomenclature of QRS. Next, what is the normal duration of a QRS? See, how many boxes I have drawn? 1, 2, actually you can include 3 small squares. Okay, just see in an ECG, if QRS complexes is, see QRS, 3 words, if it is greater than 3 small squares means, then it is a wide QRS. Okay, and so normal duration will be, if it is 3 small squares, 0.08 to 0.12 is the normal duration of a QRS complex. Okay, so if it is less than 0.08, then we call it as narrow QRS complex. These terms you should remember with respect to tachycardias. When we approach any tachycardia, we'll be seeing how to deal with a QRS complex. Okay, so this is wide and narrow QRS complexes. Got it? So yes, next we will go to T wave. So what happens now? Ventricles is completely depolarized. Ventricles is completely depolarized. So see here, atrium is depolarized. Then AV node, it went to bundle of his and ventricles. Ventricles were completely depolarized, leading to QRS complexes. This gave to P wave. This current state gave to PR interval. See, now what happens? The entire current is like, now there is a phase of isoelectric line. Meaning, as we told, in PR interval, no voltage difference was there. At the same time, here also there will be no voltage difference. That segment corresponds to ST segment. Okay. P, QRS, before the start of P, there is an isoelectric line which is ST. Okay. This ST segment importance is with respect to myocardial infarctions and electrolyte abnormalities. Okay. Nice. Good. So we will be seeing, what is a T wave, how it is produced, and what are its abnormalities? Okay, nice. So, what is a T wave? Why it is produced? See, the ventricles is completely depolarized now. Now, it should start repolarizing. Okay, so what should happen? Negative charges should start pouring in. Like, it should become negatively charged. Okay, so the direction will be like this. See this. Repolarization vector direction will be like this. So, if a depolarization vector move towards the lead, then we call it as a positive deflection. If repolarization vector move towards a lead, then negative charges are coming towards. So it will be a negative deflection. Okay. So here is lead 2. Okay. Now repolarization vector is moving away from lead 2. So it will be a positive or it will be a negative deflection. T wave will be positive or negative in lead 2. Good. Come on, people, start interacting. It will be easy for you. So it will be a positive deflection. So actually, if you see, there is this normal asymmetricity of a T wave. See here. If you take a T wave, the duration is similar. Same one large box. This is the duration. And if you take a T wave, normally it will be asymmetrical. Like if you divide it into two halves, it won't be equal in both the halves. That means it is asymmetric. Normally, it is asymmetrical. Okay. So, now what you do is, we'll ask about the amplitude. Sir, we have discussed amplitude for P waves, QRS, everything we have saw. But now, what about the height or amplitude of P wave? What is the height of normal height of T wave is, there is no normal particular value for height of a T wave. Okay. If you want to calculate the height of a T wave, then go and see the nearby QRS complexes, the preceding QRS complexes. Okay. If you see the preceding QRS complexes, see here, this height of T wave and the height of QRS complexes. This T wave height is less than 20% of height of QRS. Okay. If that is the case, then it is a low voltage T wave. Then, or if the height of T wave is more than 40% of height of QRS. See this. It's almost 100%. If it is like this, then we call it as tall T waves. Okay. So, where can we see a low voltage T waves? Can someone say any examples for low voltage T waves? Can someone say any cause for low voltage T waves? Pericarditis. Okay. Okay. I'll say it is hypokalemia will cause. And non-specific changes can also cause low voltage T waves. This is not much to worry. Okay, what we should worry is this tall T waves. What happens if there is a tall T wave? See, how to proceed. If there is a tall T wave, you have found that you have had tall T waves. Then you should see for the symmetricity of the T waves. Okay, we told if it is asymmetry, it is a normal variant. It is a normal variant. It can be a normal variant. Okay. If it is symmetrical, it is abnormal. If tall T wave is symmetrical, it is abnormal. Then what are the main two differentials? One is MI, earliest phase of MI, earliest marker of myocardial infarction. Okay. In ECG is this hyperacute tall T waves. Okay. So, and we have also hyperkalemia. Those people who would have attended my discussion, they would have known this fact. So, what is there in MI and hyperkalemia is, you should see the base of the T wave and tip of the T wave. If the base of the T wave is somewhat broad and if it is blunted, then your heart is also blunting. Myocardial infarction is there. Okay. Or if you find a tall T wave, then the base is narrow with a pointed tip. Pointed tip telling potassium disturbance. Potassium is increased. Okay. Pointed tip, narrow base. And if you see the QT interval, usually in MI it will be prolonged. And in hyperkalemia it will be decreased. There is one more clue for you. Because even in a collapsed patient might present with hyperkalemia. Okay. At that time, you can't differentiate between MI and hyperkalemia. At that time, just seeing the morphology of a T wave and seeing the QT interval will just give you an overall idea of what's going on. Okay. By just seeing the ECG, you can start potassium correction, or by just seeing the ECG, you can start doing this loading dose. Okay. Next. In MI, if as time progresses, there will be ST elevations and cardio biomarkers will be elevated. And in hyperkalemia, there will be multiple blocks will be there. And in severe process, they will result in ventricular tachycardia and death. Okay. So, this is with respect to approach in a case of tall T wave. Okay. Everyone got it? It's a tall T wave. Can I move forward? So next, Next, we should know one more wave in the ECG, which is U waves. Why U wave is formed? Can someone say? Why U waves are formed? It is due to? Come on, start guessing. Good, good, Ranjit, Ganesh, Maurya, Tani. No. Yeah, hypokalemia will cause U wave, but normally, it is repolarization of papillary muscle will cause a U wave even in normal individuals. Okay. So, how to say whether it's pathological or whether it's normal? Okay. As someone told na Maurya Tarani, like hypokalemia causes U waves. So how to tell whether it is pathological or how to say it is normal? Okay. So first is, see the U waves, the T wave, usually if you see this, the T wave is due to repolarization of ventricles and delayed repolarization of papillary muscle. This is the normal morphology of U wave. But what happens in pathological U waves is, this T wave will get shortened and U wave starts to dominate. Okay, if this is there, then it's 100% pathological. If U wave is dominating, means it is 100% pathological. Okay, so if prominent U waves are there, then we should, the differentials are, one is hypokalemia, one more is hypothermia. Come on, start interacting. What is one more cause of prominent U waves? And if you find some U wave inversions, then this might also can correlate with MI. Okay, so this is the normal finding with respect to U waves. Okay, nice. So that's it. So now we have seen all the waves in an ECG, segments in an ECG. Now we are going to see what are the intervals. Then we will be dealing with bradyarrhythmias. No, actually, there is no specific reason of why it occurs. Okay. Now, we will see with the intervals. So, as we told, PR interval. Just remember in mind, one large box is PR interval. If it is greater than one large box, then we say it has prolonged PR interval. Okay, next is RR interval. What does RR interval means? With RR interval, what can I calculate? This is the interval used to calculate our heart rate. How will you calculate heart rate? See here. RR interval you should take. This is RR interval, the gap between two RRs. It might be, you can take small boxes or you can also take large boxes. So, if you take small boxes, you should just want to take those number of small boxes between two R waves. Okay. And if you take large boxes, you will be taking 300 divided by number of large boxes in between two RRs. Or if it is small boxes, 1500 divided by number of small boxes within two RRs. Okay, but this is easy. Just 300 by, just calculate this. Normal heart rate is 60 to 100 na. So, for a heart rate of 60, there should be 5 large boxes within it. at the same time, for the heart rate to be 100, there should be 3 large boxes between it. So if you know this calculation, it's very easy. Immediately after seeing an ECG, you can say whether it's a tachycardia or bradycardia. Just see the time interval between two RR waves. If the large boxes, if you find, if it is less than 3 means it is a tachycardia. If it is greater than 5 means it is a bradycardia. Because heart rate less than 60 is brady. And heart rate greater than 100 is tachy. So, less than 3 boxes means, large box means tachycardia. Greater than 5 large boxes means bradycardia. Okay, this we will utilize for calculation of heart rate. Next, what is QT interval? Can someone say what is QT interval and what is corrected QT interval? See, QT interval means the interval from onset of QRS complex to the ending of T wave. Okay, this is a QT interval. This includes QRS wave, ST segment, and T wave. Okay, so QT interval actually says the electrical activity happening in ventricles completely. Both depolarization, QRS, and repolarization, which is T wave. So, complete electrical activity happening in the ventricles is dictated by QT interval. Okay, nice. So, what is the normal duration of QT interval? There is a formula for calculating corrected QT interval. Because if heart rate varies, QT interval can also vary. Okay, there is a formula which is known as Bessette's formula, which is QT divided by square root of RR. Just for namesake, remember this formula, but we won't be applying much with respect to ECGs. Okay, good, Ganesh Kumar. Nice. Revati, you are saying 0.4 is normal QT interval. Okay, I'll say. Small clue to remember this QT corrected interval, normal duration. Just remember 3, 4, 5 numbers. Okay. 3, 4, meaning if it is less than 0.34, then it is short QT interval. 4, 5, meaning if it is greater than 0.45 seconds, then it is long QT. Okay, so normal duration will be 0.34 to 0.45. Okay, this you can remember with respect to QT interval, normal duration. So, this is a graph representing cardiac action potential. So, can someone help me how to draw this graph? What is happening here? Cardiac action potential is this graph. What is happening in this phase? What ion is going in? Come on, everyone, be active. What ion is going in this phase? Good. Sodium ion is entering in, and this is the depolarization phase in the ventricles. Okay. Then, what is this phase represents? What ion is going out? Potassium starts to go out. Okay. Then, why it is a plateau? Potassium starts to go out, but what positive ion is coming in? Good, Ravi Anandan, Kerstes. What positive ion is coming in? Good. Calcium ion is coming in and making it as a plateau. Then what ion continues to go out continuously? A plus. This is the normal action potential happening in the ventricles. Okay, so with this, how can I remember ECG? Is CR. This represents depolarization of ventricles. Na? So this will represent the QRS complex. Okay, next, what happens? There is an isoelectric line here. So that will be the ST segment. Okay, next, repolarization is going on. That will contribute to T waves. Okay, so my question is, how will QT interval prolong and how will QT interval be shortened with these ion disturbances? Can someone say? If there is hypercalcemia, what will happen? So see, this is the QT interval, Q to T. Same time, this is the QT interval. Okay, so what happens is, in hypercalcemia, what happens is, more of calcium is outside the cell. So it will move fast and finish this phase quickly. So what happens? This phase is getting shortened. Okay, so QT interval will also be shortened. So any causes of hypercalcemia, like hypercalcemia or hyperparathyroidism, or any cause of increasing calcium into the myocytes. Can you say some drug used in congestive cardiac failure which will load calcium into the myocytes? Can you say some drug which is used in congestive cardiac failure which will load calcium into the myocytes and help in contractility? Good, Savita, Eliyarasu. It is digoxin. So all this hypercalcemia, digoxin, hyperparathyroidism will increase the calcium levels. So what happens is, this segment is getting shortened. So QT interval is also getting shortened. Okay, so if you want to know only one ion and you should want to remember all the causes of short QT, means it's calcium elevated. Okay, elevated calcium, either it might be in the myocytes or it might be hypercalcemia or it might be hyperparathyroidism. Okay, this is short QT. Then we are going to see long QT syndromes. So you would have learned some long QT syndromes. Congenitally, there can be. Like many syndromes are there, like Brugada syndromes, many syndromes are there. Then I want to discuss this electrolyte abnormality alone. So I am asking, what changes in potassium and calcium can result in prolonged QT? Can someone say? What changes in potassium and calcium will result in prolonged QT? Good, Revati. So, yeah, Ravi Anandan, nice. Hypokalemia and hypocalcemia, what happens is, the cell will take longer time to depolarize and longer time to cause this QT. So, QT prolongation is seen if these ions are reduced. Okay. At the same time, hypothermia and hypomagnesemia is also a cause for prolonged QT. Okay, these four you should remember with respect to prolonged QTs. Because if long QTs are there, when at any time what might happen is, see, this is a normal cardiac action potential, it is getting prolonged. So what might happen is, another action potential can start originating here. So if multiple action potential starts to occur, then it will be a ventricular tachycardia. So only they say, if long QT is there, then it is a source of ventricular tachycardia. Okay, so they are correctable cause of ventricular tachycardia: hypocalcemia, hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia and hypothermia. Okay, Everyone got it? The disorders with respect to short QT and long QT syndromes. Can I move forward? Did you understand the alkaloid disturbances and QT prolongations? Okay. So then there is actually one more important question with respect to drugs causing prolonged QT. This you should remember with respect to NEET as well as any exam, because long QT, and you should also remember with respect to clinics, because if you give some drug and if it causes long QT, then you are creating ventricular tachycardia in the patient. So how to remember the drugs causing long QT syndromes? Just remember COVID treatment. What and all drugs we were giving in COVID treatment? One is HCQs. Yes, it will prolong the QT. Next, azithro. It will prolong the QT. And we will be giving cetirizine, antihistamines. Yes, it will prolong the QT. And COVID, what happens to the patient? Psychosis happens. So, antipsychotics. All these drugs prolong the QT interval. So, if a patient is a cardiac patient, cardiac disorder patient, means it is good that you don't give HCQs and all. Okay. So, that is the reason behind learning this long QTs. At the same time, you should remember clindamycin antibiotic and quinolones. Like we would have learning now, fluoroquinolones, like levofloxacin. So only in pneumonia patient and all, what we won't do is, we won't give levo plus azithro and all. This combination is never practiced because of the fear of prolongation of QT interval. Okay, we will either give cephalosporins and levofloxacin, or we will change the combinations. Okay. Yeah. Okay, nice. Then antiarrhythmics, class 1 and class 1A and 1C and class 3, they have maximum risk for QT prolongation. Just need to write it, copy it down. Can I move forward? Okay. Thank you. Okay. So this is the list you can see afterwards. What are the drugs causing long QT intervals? Okay. Nice. So there comes our topic, which is bradyarrhythmias. Okay. So how to approach bradyarrhythmia? What is bradyarrhythmia actually? What happens to the heart rate in bradyarrhythmia? Heart rate is less than how much? Good. It is less than 60 with respect to bradyarrhythmia. Good. So, bradyarrhythmias can be due to two causes. One is, the current is not at all formed, or the current is formed but it is not at all conducted. Conduction via the AV node is a problem. Or conduction via the bundle of branches is the problem. Left bundle branch, right bundle branch, blocks might be there. AV blocks might be there. Or current formation itself is the problem. Current is formed in the SA node. It might be a sinus bradycardia, or it might be sinus arrest. Arrest means the SA node no more produces P waves, leading to sinus arrest. This is the broad classification of bradyarrhythmias. Okay. So, yes, now we are going to answer. Look for the large boxes in between RR intervals. It should be more than how many large boxes? Can someone say it should be more than how many large boxes should be there in between RR intervals to call it as bradycardia? Good, Revati. Surya, it is, if it is less than 3, we call it as tachycardia. If it is greater than 5, we call it as bradycardia. Good, Ilavarasi, Revati, Elilarasu. It is greater than 5. So just count it. We have found out it is a bradycardia going on. So now we should go and apply our concepts and we should differentiate the types of bradyarrhythmias. Okay, nice. First, sinus bradycardia. So what happens in sinus bradycardia is nothing but just the rate is reduced. That's all. Heart rate, the rate of firing of SA node is reduced to less than 60. Nothing has happened except this change. Okay. T waves is there or not? Come on, just answer these things. Bradyarrhythmia is over. T waves is there or not in the sinus bradycardia? Yes. Good. What about the PR interval duration and PR interval variability? P wave is here. Yes. What is the PR interval duration? AV node, does this disease cause any disease of AV node? Is AV node is at fault? No. So PR interval will be normal and it will be constantly conducted. Whatever impulse it gives, it will be conducted. Okay, AV node is normal. If AV node is normal, means this PR interval duration and constancy will be maintained. And P is to QRS. For every P wave, there is one QRS. So only change here. Is it regular or not? Rhythm? Regular. So only change with respect to sinus bradycardia is heart rate is less than 60. That's all. Rest everything is normal with respect to sinus bradycardia. Okay. Nice. Can I move forward? Next, we'll be having small stories of how to remember the types of AV nodal blocks. Can I move forward? Everyone wrote it? Okay. Nice. So this is first degree heart block. What happens is, if here we'll be saying some series of stories of how to remember these degrees of heart blocks. So here AV block is there, meaning AV node is not functioning properly. Okay. How it is classified? It is first degree, second degree, third degree. Okay. First degree, what happens? It's like we can have four kinds of workers here. Okay, how are the workers working in a factory or something? Small story to make you remember types of AV block. First is first degree heart block is an old worker and a sincere worker. Okay, whatever worker we call it as P wave. Okay, and the time taken for him to complete the work, we call it as PR interval. Time interval, na? PR interval. And if he has completed that work, then we give him some bonus or some fee, salary, which is QRS. Okay, so here what happens? This is an old man. But he is a sincere worker. Will he do the work or not? Yes. What will be the time taken for him to do that work? Will it be normal? Or will it be more than the others? What will be the time taken for him to do a work, given work? Will it be normal or more than the others? Yes. Increased. Good. Yeah, prolonged. Nice. So here if you see, good Ravi, here if you see P wave, yeah, it is there. PR interval, it is prolonged, but he does the work, yes, and he does it regularly. Okay, so PR interval is constant. This is important. There are two terms I'll be talking. One is constancy of PR interval and duration of PR interval. Okay, duration means the net time taken, and constancy means you should compare with all the PR intervals in the ECG. If you see all the PR intervals are normal, all the PR intervals are constant and prolonged. If you see that kind of a block, it is the first degree hard block. You can remember as old is gold. This is the first degree. Okay, old sincere worker, he takes more time, but he does constant work. At the same time, he gets his fee and P wave is there. Got it? This is first degree hard block. Everyone got these terms? Can you move forward? Okay. So now you people should say, what is the heart rate in first degree hard block? What is the heart rate in first degree AV block? It will be, less than 60. Yes. P wave is there or not? Yes. QRS there or not? Yes. For every given work, this old man does the work and gets his salary. Yes. What is the PR interval duration? It is prolonged. What is the PR interval variability? No, it's not varying. He does it at the constant rate. Okay. What can be the causes means they will say increased vagal tone might be a cause, because we know parasympathetic will inhibit the AV node mildly. Okay, this you should remember with respect to first degree heart block, AV block. Okay, if see here, if this first degree heart block is associated with some bifascicular blocks, like see here, LBB is going on, our bundle branch is blocked. At the same time, if this is also blocked, means at one point of time, heart rate cannot go down. Electric current can't even go down. That means the patient might result in complete heart block anytime. Okay. Only if it is associated with this kind of blocks, then we should treat the patient with pacemaker. Otherwise, not much of treatment is needed. Treatment aspects we'll be discussing in detail, but still you should remember that if it is associated with some bundle branch blocks, first degree heart block, then any time it might result in complete heart block and the patient might die. So that becomes an indication for pacemaker implantation. Got it? Can we move to next degree? Okay. Second degree heart block. What is this worker? He is one new worker who is enthusiastic. Okay. Immediately after joining the job, he will be like, okay, I'll work like anything. First few days he'll be like, company is my everything, like that. So he'll be working and doing his job. He will be running and doing all the jobs. Okay, then what happens after some 1 or 2 days? What happens to his working nature? He will be starting to feel tired. Okay, after that, what happens? At one point of time, this guy falls off. That's all, I can't do any more work hereafter. Then suddenly he's like, He's enthusiastic, na? Suddenly he gets up and he's like, no, I will do the work again with greater speed. Okay? He's doing this kind of a cycle, routine cycle. Like, first what he did, he joined his job. He's like working continuously and fast. And after some time, what happened? He started to faint because he can't do at that much speed. Then what happened? He collapsed. Then also, since he's enthusiastic, he got up and started working again. So how does this correlate with the second degree heart block? See, first, I told you, time, P wave is there or not? Yes, he is the P wave. He is there, good. What about the PR interval? First, it is short. Then, it was thought as an increased, prolonged. It kept on prolonging. At one point of time, he couldn't do the work. That means he won't get the salary with this QRS. Then what happened? He instantly got up and started working like a madman. So now PR interval will be shortest. And will he get a salary? Yes. So now if you see, this is the pattern which we call it as C. Here, what happens? PR prolongates, then prolongates, then what happens? QRS is missing, followed by shortest PR interval. This is the type 1 block, Mobitz type 1 of second degree heart block. Mobitz type 1 of second degree heart block. Everyone got it? Heart block. PR interval slowly prolongs until one time what happens? He strokes off. No QRS is there. Then the shortest PR interval will be immediately after the drop repeat. This is with respect to Mobitz type 1. Okay. This short story you can remember. He's a new enthusiastic worker. Like you can remember like type 1 na. So after doing day 1 of work, how he is behaving. Next what happens? Same second degree block, we have Mobitz type 2. What happens in Mobitz type 2? Let's see this story. Here what happens? That same worker got experienced. Now he is like, okay, I should work smart as well as I should be taking rest also. I shouldn't be working continuously. So what he does is, whatever work given to him, he does it on time. Okay, whatever work given to him, he does it on time and he gets the salary. Yes. And what he does is, he does some 2-3 times work, then he takes rest. Whatever work you give him now, he won't do. So, here is P wave sitting. He is not doing any work, so the QRS will be there. No. But after taking rest, he continues to do his work. Now he finishes the work at the normal time, which means PR interval will be mostly normal in this second degree Mobitz type 2. Okay, so depending on the rest frequency he gives, we classify this Mobitz type 2 into two types. Sorry, second degree AV block. There is Mobitz type 1 we saw. Then there is Mobitz type 2 and there is advanced 2:1 heart block. Okay, here he gives rest frequency of, like, he does at least two work he will do and then he will take a rest. But here It is 2 is to 1 or 3 is to 1. Meaning, here what happens is, a P wave will be there, QRS. P wave will be there, QRS. Then what happens is, he misses off. He misses off, no QRS. Okay, this is Mobitz type 2. Wait, I will have drawn a diagram here. See here. So, see here, PR interval is normal. What happens here? Sorry, this example of Mobitz type 1. You can see this example itself. What happens is, same this thing, P wave, no QRS. Next P wave, one QRS. P wave, no QRS. It is like two P waves are there, only one is conducted. Then it is 2 is to 1 hard block. If it is at least two waves, more than two waves, at least two waves are conducted means, then we call it as Mobitz type 2. Got it? This is with respect to classification of AV, second degree AV blocks. Anyone having some doubts? What he does is, whatever work given to him, he does at the normal time. He is an experienced worker as well as a smart worker. Like, he gives some rest and he does some job. This applies even to your neat preparation. Like, no need to study continuously, enthusiastically at the initial point of time. Then you will be fed up at the exam time. You won't be able to concentrate that much. Okay. So, this is experienced smart worker. And this is enthusiastic new worker. This is type 1. And this is type 2 and advanced block we saw. Good. Next. Nice. So we will fill in the blanks here. So Mobitz type 1. New worker. You can remember like new worker. PR interval will be varying or constant for Mobitz type 1. PR interval will be varying or constant. Good. Devati, Kalpana, Ganesh, Ravi Anandan, good. It is varying. Whereas here, what about the PR interval? It will be constant. This is the most important differentiating factor. Okay. And duration of PR interval will be, all kind of things will be there. Short, prolonged, normal, all combinations will be here. But here mostly it will be normal. Okay. Next, P is to QRS ratio. How it will be there? Like Wenckebach's phenomenon. So, like after multiple P waves, there will be a loss of one QRS. But here it will be regularly, there will be loss of QRS complex. Like it might be 3 is to 2, 2 is to 1, 3 is to 1. Okay. Now my question is, if it is 3 is to 2, what we will call? And if it is 2 is to 1, 3 is to 1, what we will call the type of second degree hard block? Yeah. Mobitz, you should remember with respect to all kind of preparation, NEET as well as AVALA. This is important actually, Mobitz. So if it is 3 is to 2 only, we call it as Mobitz type 2. This we call it as advanced second degree hard block. Okay. So can I move forward? Good. All other as advanced. Nice. So last and the final hard block. What is this? Third degree hard block. How will this be? See, here what happens is, now after working so much time, what the worker has done? He has gained lots of experience. Now he is like, why to work under that fool and give money to them? Let me start my own startup. He starts up a new company and he starts running. Since he is some good experience and smart worker, his rate of functioning will be more. Since he has started new, his rate of functioning will be more. And what happened to the owner of the factory? He is like, no one is left to help him. So he is doing his work by his own. But still, he is not that much capable of this worker, na? So his rate will be low and his rate will be high. Okay. Here, this owner is running within the ventricles. He is running within the atrium. So there will be coordination between him. So PP intervals will be how much and RR intervals will be how much. He will do his work according to his own nature constantly. So RR interval will be constant and PP interval will be constant. He will be doing his own work at his own rate. So since he is directed by this SA node, na, so his rate will be usually more than 100. And since he is directed by what? AV node and bundle of his. So his rate will be less than 60. Mostly it will be less than 40. Which we call it as idioventricular rhythm. Okay. This is with respect to third degree heart block. Got it? Here what happens? They get segregated. It's a new worker, new startup, started up, all these things. E wave is increased, interventricular rhythm is followed in the ventricles. Okay. This is 3 degrees of heart blocks for you. Got it? So first we were discussing about second degree heart block, the AV block. We discussed about the old sincere worker who was working continuously, constantly, but takes more time to work. PR interval is constant and prolonged, except other than that, everything is normal. Then we saw second degree heart block, where he was a new enthusiastic worker. He was running and doing the work fast at the time. Next, PR interval was prolonging. At one point of time, he couldn't do the job and QRS was missed at that time. After getting up, he started to work more efficiently. PR interval was shortest after that pass. Okay. Next, we were seeing Mobitz type 2 and advanced type 3 block is an example of experienced and smart worker who does job like whatever job given to him, he will do the job in a proper time. And whatever work you give after that, he won't do it. Okay. If he does at least 2 works, then we call it as Mobitz type 2. If he does only in 2 work, if you give only 1 work, he does means then it is 2:1 or 3:1 heart blocks. Like this, it will be. Okay, these are advanced heart blocks. Okay. Next is what happens? Third degree heart block. He has started a new startup. So he is working at his own rate, but to driven by SA node. So it will be 100 and upper. And he owner is working under AV node. So it is like less than 40. This is the idioventricular rhythm. So if you see RR intervals, it will be constant. And if you see PP intervals, that will also be constant. These are degrees of heart blocks. Okay. Can we now go and see how to approach an ECG with respect to heart block? I'll just say some points about third degree heart blocks. Okay. First is supra his heart block and infra his heart block. Just 2 extra edge points. Like third degree complete heart block, what we see is this is the AV node and this is the bundle of his. and Purkinje fibers. This complete block might be in the AV node, or it might be in the bundle of His. Both are complete hard blocks only, na? Since it is completely obstructed, electrical activity can't pass. Complete hard block only. But if it is supra complete, means the heart rate will be, at least they will maintain 40 to 60. If it is infra His, means heart rate only will be 20 to 40. Okay. So next is, see here. This way will come afterwards. What is the MI causing this kind of heart blocks? If bundle of branches are affected, bundle of His is affected, means what kind of MI might cause this heart block? Yeah, AV deficiency is in third degree only. Bundle of branch is affected means what kind of MI will cause this kind of block? And if AV node is affected means what kind of MI will cause that kind of a block? What will be the culprit artery? So for this, you should be knowing what is the normal blood supply of AV node. AV node is supplied by what blood clot artery? And bundle of His and bundle branches are supplied by which artery? Can someone say? Good. RCF or AV node. And if it is LAD, means actually conducting system, if you see, SA node and AV node is supplied by RCA. Okay. And bundle of His and all the bundle branches are supplied by LAD. Okay. So if it is an anterior MI, this we will be seeing in next section. Don't worry. Anterior MI, it will involve, if it involves the LAD, then you can expect infranodal, infra His complete heart block. If it is RCA involving MI, then it will involve the AV node and it will cause inferior MI. We will discuss it, don't worry. And this is 40 to 60. At least here it is 40 to 60. The patient is, it's thought as a nice prognosis. Okay. But here it is 20 to 40. So it is the worst prognosis among all. So if you find this kind of block, means that's an instant indication to keep pacemaker in this patient. Pacemaker implantation. Pacemaker implantation is indicated for all the third degree heart blocks. All third degree heart blocks. Okay. That's it. So everyone got it now? Can I move forward? We are almost reaching the end of the session. Yeah. So, how to approach a bradyarrhythmia? Now, an ECG is given to you. What happens is just 5-10 more minutes. We'll just see the approach and we'll be starting our quiz. In that session, you will be given some series of ECGs and it's your job to crack what are the answers for it. Okay. So get ready and listen to this properly. So how to approach a bradyarrhythmia? First is check the heart rate. As we told, heart rate should be less than 60. That is, in between two RR intervals, it should be greater than 5 large boxes. Okay. Next. See whether P wave is there or not. If P wave is there, means then it's absolutely, it is involving, problem is in the AV node, or it might be sinus bradycardia also. If P wave is not there, means then what happened to the finest node? It has gone for, come on, now you can guess everything. We have seen the basics, now it will be easy for you to guess. Sinus has gone for, sinus arrest. Good, Kalpana. Sinus arrest. At the same time, can you people say one more tachyarrhythmia where P waves will be absent? Where P waves will be absent and you will be giving these rate control agents like calcium channel blockers, beta blockers, digoxin. Good. Good. It is atrial fibrillation. So, in atrial fibrillation patients, if you just enthusiastically treat too much, if rate control is excessively rate control happening, then we call that as, that might also be a cause for bradyarrhythmia because it is iatrogenic. Good, Savita. Nice. Next, we are going to see, now we have ruled out the sinus arrest and atrial fibrillation. Now we are going to see how to classify the AV nodal blocks and sinus bradycardia. First, what you should see? First, you should see a PR interval. PR interval you should see. Like superficially see in the ECG. First, superficially see for the heart rate. Then superficially see for the P waves. Then superficially see for the PR intervals. Don't go deep. In superficial aspects itself, just try to knock out all these extra causes. Okay. Superficially see for the PR intervals. Like, if the PR intervals are like this. If the PR intervals are varying or constant. First see that. If it is varying, then what and all can be the possibilities? I want you people to type. Good, Maurya Tarani. PR interval is varying in. Good. Next. Where also PR interval might vary? No. First degree heart block, why should it vary? Because it is fixed and prolonged. Good. Mobitz type 1 is nice. Next. What is one more thing? Where P wave will be pouring at one rate. QRS will be pouring at one more rate. So there won't be some connection between these two. So PR interval will be automatically vary. Good. Ravi Anandan, it is not advanced. Complete heart block. It is complete heart block. Ravi Anandan, what I told was in second degree heart block, advanced what happens? That is the experienced and smart worker. What he does? He finishes the work on time and he takes rest. So if you measure the PR interval in whatever complexes is there, then it will be normal only. It will be constant only. Okay. Yeah, advanced may PR interval won't vary. Because in advanced second degree, what happens is whatever the conducted beats na, in the PR interval will be constant. There it is not here. Next. Conducted may PR interval will be constant. Constant. So you should look for constancy of PR interval. Okay. Nice. So the remaining will come in these types. Like Mobitz type 2. And what are the causes? Sinus bradycardia. Then, first degree AV block, advanced second degree AV block. Okay. So, how to classify it further? Like varying PR interval means what I told, two classification, Mobitz type 1 and complete heart block. How to differentiate this? Just look for the RR interval and PQRS relationship. How will be the RR interval in case of Mobitz type 1. Mobitz type 1. How will be the RR interval? And in complete art block, how will be the RR interval? Come on, try it out. Yes, it is varying good. It is constant here. And if you also see PQRS relationship, there will be AV dissociation. It will be contracting at one rate. It will be producing at one rate. Here, you can see that Winkeback's phenomenon. Okay. So, if a bradyarrhythmia is given in exam or if you see in clinic, just pray that it's varying PR interval. If it is varying, means it's very easy to identify. Just go and see the RR interval. If it is constant or if it is varying. If it is varying, it is Mobitz type 1. If it is constant, means it's complete heart block. Very easy to diagnose these two. Okay. But as we expect, they won't ask in exams. They will ask only these four things. So how to differentiate it? If PR interval is constant. Superficially, we are seeing PR interval is constant. Then what am I going to see? I am going to see PQRS relationship. Okay. If PQRS relationship is 1 is to 1, meaning for every P wave, there is one QRS complex. If it is, that means my diagnosis will be what? In the 4, what I can rule out? 1 is to 1 means this thing I can take in, this thing can be there. Sinus bradycardia and first degree heart block can be there. So, now how to differentiate these two, sinus bradycardia and first degree heart block? Sinus bradycardia, what happens? And first degree heart block, what is the only pathology? Okay, here measure the PR interval. Measure meaning now only we are going deep and seeing into the ECG. Okay. Measure the PR interval. If PR interval, as I told previously, it was constant and the duration is increased, means this is that old worker. So first degree heart block. If the PR interval also normal, PR interval normal, PQRS relation normal, PR interval constant, everything is normal. Then P wave is also there. Only problem is heart rate less than 60 degree means, then we call it as sinus bradycardia. Okay. Then what we do is, look for PQRS relationship. If P is greater than QRS, multiple P waves are there, meaning, if it is like 2 is to 1 means, we call it as 2 is to 1, 3 is to 1 means, it is advanced second degree. If it is 3 is to 2 means, it is Mobitz type 2. Okay. Got it. This is the approach with respect to bradyarrhythmia. What did I do? Just I saw the ECG superficially. I measured the heart rate. Then I saw whether P wave is there or not. Then I saw superficially that PR interval is constant or is it varying? Varying means, is it changing with each beat like that? Then if it is varying, it's very easy. Just check the RR interval. If it is RR interval is constant, then it is complete heart block. If it is varying, it is Mobitz type 1. Then we saw PR interval was constant. We had 4 diagnoses. What did we do? We checked for the PQRS relationship. If it is 1 is to 1, means there are 2 possibilities. So we now only we went in and measured the PR interval. If PR interval was increased, it is first degree heart block. If it is normal, means everything is normal, so sinus bradycardia. And if PQRS relationship may, if we see 3:2 or 2:1, 3:1, means it is second degree heart block. Yeah, varying PR interval, vary means present or absent. No, PR interval varying means we should check PR interval in each leads. Like there will be multiple leads in ECG, na? We'll be taking like in lead 2, there will be a long strip that will be given. So we'll be taking for the PR interval. Is it, here it is 3 box, okay. Here it is 3 box, okay. Here it is 3 box. Then that means it is constant PR interval. I am not at all saying about prolonged or normal. It is constancy or varying. See, here it is like 1 box. Here is like 3 box. Here it is like 5 box. Meaning it is varying. I am not at all saying prolonged or not. I am just saying the difference between constancy and variability. Okay. Nice. So now how to approach treatment of bradyarrhythmia? See, whenever if symptomatically they are there, then we should give only if symptoms are there, like giddiness. If any symptom is there, then we will be giving injections like IV atropine, repeat up to 3 times. If you are in PHCs, we can try this. 0.5 mg IV atropine for 3 times. Then if it is not available, means if you are in some community health center or some referral hospital, you can do temporary, you can make pacing transcutaneously. And then you can take it to higher hospital, there they do permanent pacing. Okay. If nothing is available, means two more drugs can be used. One is isoproterenol and one more drug is dopamine. All these, they stimulate the conduction pathway. They improve the conduction. Okay, so first, if only if symptoms are there, you should treat bradyarrhythmia. First point, what are the symptoms? Giddiness as well as some chest pain, something might be there. Then first give atropine, repeat up to 3 doses. If not resolved, you can give temporary pacing, that is transcutaneous. Then you can go for permanent pacing. And if it is long duration, if the symptoms is there, then you can go for pacemaker implantation. If he is symptomatic for a long time. Okay. But pacemakers is indicated even in asymptomatic patients if the patient has NMJ, means neuromuscular disorders. Like many congenital heart disease patients with associated neuromuscular disorders will have an increased chance for complete heart block. So in those kind of patients, you should give pacemaker. At the same time, as we discussed, trifascicular blocks. Trifascicular blocks means right bundle branch, left bundle branch. Left bundle branch we have anterior and posterior. All fascicles are blocked means there is no conduction system working. So now you should give pacemaker. Okay, these are the indications of keeping pacemaker. This is how to treat case of bradyarrhythmia. If his symptoms, 0.5 mg atropine repeated 3 times, or if you have nothing in the PHC, then you can go for isoproterenol or dopamine or temporary pacemaker followed by permanent pacing. If he is symptomatic for a long time, then he is a candidate for permanent pacemaker. Even asymptomatic patients, you should give pacemaker if he has trifascicular blocks or NMJ disorders. That's it. This is the treatment of bradyarrhythmias. Okay? Everyone got it? Any doubts here? Can we start the quiz? Did you people understand? Any doubts here till now? We saw the approach of bradyarrhythmia, treatment of bradyarrhythmias, and the types of bradyarrhythmias is a short story. Then we were seeing QT intervals, drugs causing prolonged QT, short QT and long QT causes. Then we saw RR interval, how to calculate the heart rate. Then we saw PR interval, its importance. Then U waves, if it's prominent, how when you should say it's pathological. Then we saw tall T waves, how to approach a case of tall T wave. Then we saw T waves, normal and normal QRS, normal P waves and abnormalities of P waves, right atrial, left atrial enlargements. Okay, that's it. So now we will start our sessions. Okay, get ready. Come on. Can you start? Yes, first question. Okay, nice. So, yes, all features can be expected in this patient except first, A, large A waves. Come on, I want everyone to type their answers so that we will be calculating your points. Okay, nice. Let's start. All features can be expected in this patient except a large A wave, a large A wave in JVP. Okay. Large A wave in JVP. Lithium intake in pregnancy, soft S1, diastolic murmur can be heard. Come on, I want everyone to answer now. Just you make answers and make mistakes. Learn from the mistakes. Come on. Write out. Come on. So, what is the ECG showing? Yeah, 1 minute you have. What is the ECG showing here? I'm giving some clue. All features can be seen except a large wave in A wave in JVP, lithium intake in pregnancy, soft S1, diastolic murmur can be heard. Come on, everyone start answering. Want maximum responses. Okay. Nice. Next. This finding is seen in all except. Okay. Yeah. Next question. This finding is seen in all except. I'll give you one clue. just what is this? And now start thinking. Good. Okay. Nice. So, yeah, actually, it has multiple options. Can you guess what are the two multiple options here? Okay. So, anyone answering? Good, good. Okay. Let's go to the next question. PR interval prolongation signifies disease of AV node, disease of SA node, disease of atrium, disease of ventricle. PR interval prolongation signifies disease of AV node, SA node, atrium, ventricles. Nice, just mark the question number and give your response. Now it will be easy for us. Good. Next. 40-year-old patient presents with shortness of breath and ECG was taken. What does this ECG indicate? Shortness of breath was there. ECG was taken. What does this ECG indicate? A. Hyperkalemia. B. Earliest feature of myocardial infarction. Normal variant. Hypothermia. Good, come on, give it a try. Try for this question. 40-year-old female, male, presents with shortness of breath and ECG was taken. And ECG showed this change. Hyperkalemia, earliest feature of MI, normal variant or hypothermia. Nice. Okay. Let's go to the next question. All of the following can cause this except. What is this? Fifth question. keep this option as, cancel this option. Okay, all of the following can cause this except hypomagnesemia, hypokalemia, congenital long QT syndrome. What is this? Okay, nice. Okay, next, calculate the heart rate in this ECG. This is actually a bit tricky, but you will learn a new concept here. Can you find any change here? Should we include this large box in between, or this large box in between, or this one in between? Good. Move forward. Okay. If this condition is seen with bifascicular block, what is the treatment of choice? If this condition is seen with bifascicular block, then what is the treatment of choice? Atropine, pacemaker, epinephrine, ibuprofenamide. What is this condition? I'm zooming out. Zooming in, see. If this condition is associated with bifascicular block, what is the treatment of choice? Atropine, pacemaker, epinephrine, procainamide. Okay. Good. Next. What is the diagnosis? Mobitz type 2, type 1, complete heart block, sinus bradycardia. What is the diagnosis? See here. What is the diagnosis? options. Good. Nice. Okay. Next. Okay, next. Same options. What is the diagnosis? Just apply the approach which we learned. You will definitely get it. Type 1, type 2, complete ad block, sinus brady. Nice. Think again. Let's move to next question. What does the marked wave represent? Depolarization from endo to epi, depolarization from epi to endo, repolarization from endo to epi, or repolarization from epi to endo? Okay. If myocardial infarction is suspected in this patient, what is the culprit artery? If myocardial infarction is suspected in this patient, then what is the culprit artery? Here you can't find any ST changes and all. Just to check your application, that's all. What is the heart rate here? That will give a clue. Next. You are a resident posted in PHC. A patient presents to the PHC with complaints of giddiness, lightheadedness, fatigue for 1.5 hours. What is the most appropriate next line management? PHC may you take the ECG, patient has this complaints, and the ECG shows this. What will you do for this patient? Will you give IV atropine? Will you give refer to tertiary hospital for pacemaker implantation? Will you observe for some time? If he is still asymptomatic, then discharge. Or send the patient home as there is no MA changes. What will you do? Patient has these complaints. You have an ECG. What you will do in a PHC? Will you give some injections or will you refer to tertiary hospital? Okay. Nice. Next. Patient comes to a PHC again. On examination, pulse rate was 50. Okay, examination pulse rate was just 50, but he was asymptomatic other than few episodes of dry cough. ECG was done. What is the most appropriate next line management? To give atropine, to refer for pacemaker transplantation, or observe. If he is still asymptomatic, you can discharge or send the patient home as there are no MA changes. Heart rate is 50, asymptomatic, is in a PHC. What you will do? Nice. Next. That's it. That's it. So now we'll see the answers for the question. So yes, first question. What was this? What is this? See here. What is the abnormality, P wave abnormality seen here? What is the P wave abnormality seen here. Good. P pulmonale. So, if P pulmonale is there, then that means here is tricuspid stenosis. Okay. If tricuspid stenosis or tricuspid atresias are there, then there will be through the stenosed valve, the right atrium will be pumping forcefully, leading to large A wave in JVP. Yes, it can be there. And lithium intake in pregnancy can cause what syndrome? Epstein's anomaly, leading to atrialization of right ventricle. There also right atrium might be bigger, so that might also cause P pulmonale. Next, diastolic murmur can be heard. Yeah, it is stenotic tricuspid stenosis, so diastolic murmur might be there. Where soft S1 can be heard? Soft S1 can be heard in MS, which causes mid-diastolic murmur, okay, and which causes P mitral, not P pulmonale. Okay, so the answer is C. Good. Next, this finding is seen in all except. What is this finding? Yeah, QT prolongation. So QT prolongation will be seen in hypocalcemia, yes, hypokalemia, yes, this you can't see, this you can't see. These two will lead to short QT intervals. Answer is C and D. Good, Vignesh. Next, PR interval prolongation signifies disease of, yeah, AV node. Next, a 40-year-old patient presents with shortness of breath and ECG was taken. What does this signify? What was this ECG? It has this tall T waves, but see the T wave. It has a broad base and a blunt apex. So broad base and blunt apex indicates MI. Okay, even though hyperkalemia is the differential diagnosis, by seeing the morphology, it is a broad base and a blunt apex. And also if you measure the QT interval also, it will be thodasa increased. So all these pointing towards MI physiology. MI. Okay. Nice. Next. What is this wave in ECG? All of the following can cause this wave except. Yeah. It is a U wave caused due to repolarization of papillary muscles. If it is pathological, it can be seen in hypokalemia and congenital long QT syndromes. Okay. Hypomagnesemia, it won't be there. Since it is long QT, na, what happens? There is long duration for repolarization of ventricles and time for repolarization of papillary muscle. So only there is a U wave in long QT syndrome. Okay. Good. Calculate the heart rate. So, what's the problem here? Why can't we calculate the heart rate properly here? See, the rhythm is not normal. It is an irregular rhythm. See the RR interval here. See the RR interval here. See the RR interval here. It's not regular. So, if it is irregular means, then you should count 30 boxes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Like this 30 boxes you should count. Then you should count the number of QRS complexes. Okay. That will come to around 18. Into 10 you should put. That is the heart rate in irregular rhythm. How to calculate the heart rate if the rhythm is irregular like this? Okay, it is not a today topic, but still, it's better you know this. Okay, irregular rhythm is there means then you should give this calculation. You should count 30 large boxes because 30 into large box means 0.2 second. That means 6 seconds. So, count the number of QRS complexes in 6 seconds? How much? 18. Okay. So I want for 1 minute, how is the heart rate? How much is the heart rate? So multiply by 10. 60 seconds, I will get the heart rate. 180. Everyone got it? How to calculate heart rate in irregular rhythm? Nice. Next. If this condition is seen with bifascicular block, what we will do? What is this condition? See here. Now I will say how to approach this. First, you measure the heart rate. Heart rate is less than 60. So bradyarrhythmia. First, you have told bradyarrhythmia. Next, you are going to find out the PR interval. If it is constant or varying. See the constancy. Same number of boxes. Same number of boxes. So constant PR interval. Constant PR interval means. Next. What you should see if it is a constant PR interval? Then you should go and see for the PQRS relationship. All P is followed by QRS. Yes. 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 Everything is followed by QRS. Good. So our differential will be first degree heart block versus sinus bradycardia. Okay. Now measure the PR interval. Now only I am going to see in deep. Measure the PR interval. See here. Just measure it. We told one large box is for PR interval. But here it is exceeding one large box. So if it is greater than one large box means it is greater than 0.2 second. That means it is a prolonged PR interval. Okay. It is prolonged PR interval. Then it is first degree heart block. If first degree heart block is associated with bifascicular blocks means then the treatment of choice what I told? Only in that case you should go for pacemaker implantation. Got it? How to approach bradyarrhythmia ECG. Nice. Then, what is the diagnosis of this ECG? See again, what we are seeing? First, we are seeing the heart rate. It is greater than 5 boxes. Yes, bradyarrhythmia is there. Next, you are seeing the PR interval. Constant Z. Yes, it is constant, constant, constant. Constant, 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 constant. Okay. Next, since it is constant, next what are you going to see? PQRS relationship. P is followed by QRS. Yes, 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 yes. Okay. So we are left with two DDs. One is first degree heart block. One is sinus bradycardia. Okay. So now measure the PR interval. Is the PR interval less than one large box? Yes. So that means PR interval is normal. So that means it is a sinus bradycardia. Okay, got it? Okay, good. Next, this question. This question many of them has got wrong, I think. Let's see. Yeah, reduced heart rate alone. So, what is their problem here is, see, heart rate is, less than 50, bradycardia. Next, we are going to see the PR interval, whether it varies or not. See here, short, long, long, PR means P and R. So long, here, no, nothing is here. Then shortest, long, 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 increasing, increasing, then nothing is there. So PR interval is varying. If it is varying, means no need to think of anything, only two TDs. One is Mobitz type 1. One more is complete heart block. How to differentiate it? See, for the RR interval. See for the RR interval. Here, okay, normal, normal, normal. But here, see, it's varying. It's varying. At the same time, since it's varying, we go for its Mobitz type 1. Okay? Next. What does this wave represent? It is a T wave. Repolarization. Repolarization will spread from epicardium to endocardium. Depolarization will spread from endo to epicardium. Okay? T wave is repolarization vector. Good. Next. What is this? If MA is suspected in this patient, what is the culprit artery? See, just calculate the heart rate here. Actually difficult. Just calculate the heart rate. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Around 10. Around 10. So 300 by 10 means it is 30. Meaning it is going 20 to 40 range. Then is that block caused by AV nodal blockade or infranodal? Like bundle of His, Perkin J. Is it due to this or is it due to this? Good. It is due to, it is 20 to 40 means it is severe block due to this. Then LAD is the cause of obstruction because LAD only supplies bundle branches. If it is due to this means, then it is due to RCA, where heart rate will be at least 40 to 60. Okay. And see, this is the complete heart block. See the constant nature of RR interval. See this. RR interval will be very constant. Okay. And see the varying nature of PR. PR here. PR here. PR here, PR prolongly, progressively increasing. So varying PR with constant RR. It is complete heart block. Next, what is this? This is the ECG. He is having prolonged PR intervals and constant PR interval, so it is first degree heart block with symptoms. So we are going to give him symptomatic with bradyarrhythmia means we are going to give atropine. That too in PHC we can give atropine. Next, this is the sinus brady, asymptomatic. Asymptomatic, should we need to give anything? Even if it is less than 50, no need. So, observation for some time, if it is still asymptomatic, and discharge. That's it. So, that's it. We learned some basics of ECG today. And we tried doing some quiz questions. Okay. We'll announce the winners in our WhatsApp groups. And that's it for the day, friends. Thank you.